Here is something called a ground loop, and we'll talk about how that's related to the transducers. A ground loop means I would hope to see maybe the blue curve here where there's no ground loop, but instead I see some spikes throughout the frequency spectrum, and they might be multiples of 60 or 50 hertz that are electrically induced, not really part of the structure or part of the measurement. And so it's called a ground loop. Let's talk about what could cause that. So here I have my measurement system, a SCADIS. And notice a SCADIS is typically plugged into the wall, so your mains, and it's grounded there. But then we have an accelerometer attached to our test object. It's also going to ground, but it's a different ground than what's on the mains. It's, I guess, what you'd call the structure's ground. And they're two different things, and this can create a ground loop. Have you ever seen something like that occur, Scott?
Unfortunately, I have, where the two different grounds creates this ground loop, yeah.
Yeah. So you might see this as a result, like we've mentioned before, the 60 hertz spike. Probably not a good idea to stake your whole career on, like, hey, there's some bad vibration at 60 hertz, right? Because that may not be coming from the vibration of the test object, but might be coming from a nearby power generator, the lights in your lab or something like that, right?
Yeah, I'd be very suspicious of any 60 hertz problem.
Yeah, very lightly damped 60 hertz problem.
Sure.
So if someone's talking about a lightly damped 60 hertz problem, you might want to do some double checking. If you're out in the field and you catch this, there's some things you could maybe do. You want to break one of these paths to ground. So for example, if you have one of our SimCenter SCADIS units, I can disconnect it from power because it has an internal battery that runs on DC. And when that is broken, there's only one path to ground. And if the electrical noise goes away, I know I have a ground loop. If it doesn't go away, then there's a chance that that 60 hertz is real. So quick troubleshooting, disconnect this. Now, maybe you got to measure for a kajillion hours and the battery here won't last a kajillion hours. So alternatively, what we could do is break that path to ground by using isolation pads between our transducer and the test object. Do you see how that kind of breaks that path, Scott?
Yep.
And then I can power it and keep running. So accelerometers with an isolation pad is a good thing. You can also get some accelerometers that have electrical isolation built in, like PCB, they have a J suffix. Now, other transducers where you could see things, strain gauges are usually isolated because there's like a surface that they're put on. They're not quite directly on the metal surface of the test object. But yeah, in general, you want to isolate your sensors so there's no additional path to ground, no electrical current that can flow between the two. Does that kind of make sense to you, Scott?
Yep.
Some other little things you could try. Some of you might be in labs that have an orange power plugs. Those are actually clean power. So sometimes the ground isn't all that great on regular power outlets. So you could try plugging your instrumentation to orange power. Here we have a SCADIS measurement system. And another alternative, you probably look in the box. You may not even know you have this. There is something called a ground strap, which, you know, you can screw into this SCADIS. It comes with the SCADIS. And then you can attach this side with like a bolt to the structure itself to make the ground the same between the two. And sometimes that can solve the issue.
Oh, you don't plug that ground cable into the orange outlet, though.
No, don't plug it in here. Just attach it to the structure, the test structure itself.
Okay. I got to make a phone call. Yeah. Real quick.
Okay.